And now, live in studio, cutting through your typical media nonsense and offering you a rational and unbiased perspective on current events and life in Tampa Bay, he's a successful entrepreneur, a real estate and finance expert, and goes to bat for you every day as your consumer advocate. Your host, Brandon Rhymes.
Yes, here we are again, another day committed to picking a fight with the mainstream media and providing you the timely truth centered around real estate, credit, finance, estate planning, sports talk, and so much more. You're listening to the Real Estate Quarterback Show, where our number one goal is to help educate and help our consumers win.
The only thing I'm addicted to right now is winning.
Now, I want you to pull out your smartphone and save our consumer advocate hotline number in your phone. It's 813-917-1894.
You used to call me on my cell phone.
813-917-1894.
Baby.
And I want you to bookmark our website. It's realestateradiotampa.com. Realestateradiotampa.com. This segment is brought to you by Michael Vogt. He's an expert massage therapist from Back In Health Massage, voted top 10 in Tampa Bay. Back In Health Massage, Michael Vogt, expert massage therapist, 3750 Gunn Highway in Tampa. So we got an all-star lineup for you today. Very excited to have my former coach and a quarterback himself. Coach Levitt, Jim Levitt, former USF, former 49ers, and current coach at Colorado. Welcome in, sir.
It's good to be here. I did play quarterback. I wasn't a very good one. Dixie Hollins High School in St. Petersburg, Florida. And I was recruited by everybody in America. I thought I was really, really that good. And I threw four interceptions in one game against Sarasota Riverview. And I got letters from everybody saying, good luck. I don't know where you're going to go. I had no opportunities. And ended up going to University of Missouri in Missouri Tiger. But unbelievable. That's brought back some memories. Not great memories all the time. But
yeah,
I remember that night. Not a good night when I threw those interceptions. So, hey, it's good to be here. I'll tell you, this is nice. You know, coming down here, see my mom.
Awesome.
Staying over there in St. Pete with her and my wife, Jody, and our two little girls. And took them to Disney World yesterday.
Awesome.
Long day.
Yeah.
Tough on the knees and the back. And
waiting in all the lines and whatnot. The whole Disneyland experience.
Yeah, it took me, I'm going to tell you, Connor, it took me about an hour just to buy the tickets.
You would think
I would have done something earlier. I'd been smarter than that. But, you know, we stayed with some friends over in Orlando, and then went over there and got in those long lines. And then I got on the wrong tram or whatever and ended up going to Epcot. And we had to go back to the Magic Kingdom and everywhere. But all in all, it was really nice. And it's great to be back here. You know, it's don't get back here much anymore. You know, but I grew up here, and this is my home and always will be. And, you know, it's really nice. It's great seeing you.
Likewise.
Yeah, you bring back some great memories and of those first inaugural teams at South Florida.
That's right.
I always said South Florida. They always wanted to call it USF.
Yeah.
But, you know, I never wanted to call it USF. And the reason was because you had UCF.
Right.
And all these teams, like in Louisiana, had the Northeast or the South team and all that.
Yep.
And I didn't want to be relegated to being a directional school.
Right.
And I thought it was very, very important emotionally and psychologically to call it the University of South Florida, not USF, for those reasons. Because also on TV, it took more time for it to scroll across the screen.
Right.
So it wasn't just quickly USF, it was University of South Florida. So
you're right on point. It's all about branding.
Yeah, that's how I felt.
It's all about branding and the psychological effect, you getting into the mind of the consumer, and that's what we love about the show. We've got the quarterback show here,
mm-hmm.
the real estate quarterback. We have a consumer quarterback show. It's more health, wealth, and wisdom and recreation-based. But, yeah, I love it. It's great memories as well, Coach, and I appreciate you coming in. Let's jump into that. I think maybe what we'll do is try to go in chronological order here a little bit. And let's talk about those early days. You know, we had Leroy Selman Jr. on the show some time back, and what a – the inception of USF football. You know, maybe give us the quick version of that story. You know, how did it come about? And thanks for your efforts for that.
Well, the person to start, you can say all you want, but the guy that really started football, and if you're very honest, is Paul Griffin.
Right.
Paul Griffin was the athletic director that hired me. He was the one that went through all the border regions, the different hurdles that he had to go through to start the program. Now, he was the one that hired Leroy Selman, and that name brought incredible credibility to the University of South Florida.
Right.
And there was 120 applicants, I know, for the job. Came down to 12. I remember talking to Paul, and then it came down to 6 and came in and interviewed. And you know, it was easy for me to talk about the program because, well, there wasn't a program, but to talk about, you know, what could be done there because I had so much passion, you know, for the university because I grew up here.
Yeah.
And mom, dad were here and had a lot of family members. My brother, a minister in Bradenton, so it was really, really something. So I remember I was making $75,000 at Kansas State University being a defense coordinator, and I'll never forget. Paul offered me $75,000, and I went to Paul and I said, Paul, is there a way, you know, this is a lateral move. I'm making $75,000 now. Is there any way you could pay me a little bit more money? And he looked at me and said, no. And I said, thank you, sir. I appreciate being the head coach at South Florida. And that was it. You know, and our salary pool, which I think people might enjoy hearing, was $90,000.
Wow.
That's not for one coach.
Wow.
That was for 10 coaches, because we in 1AA you could have so many, and you had 6 and 4, and I don't want to go into all of it, but my coordinators made, think about this, my coordinators made $34,000 apiece.
Yep.
So that's, you added up how much money you think I had left to 64. Hire like 8 guys or 6 guys. I hired guys for a dorm room. I hired one guy for $1,000. I hired another guy for a dorm room also. I mean, it was unbelievable. And we only had, I think, $60,000 in our budget. And the sprinkler system went down right away. And that cost, through unions and everything, it cost $60,000 to fix, so we had to have grass fields, so you can only imagine. So we went pretty quick, and you know, first game, never forget, Kentucky Wesleyan, 60, I don't know, it was sellout. It was almost sellout. I guess it wasn't quite, 51,000.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember. But it was so unbelievable because the people here were and have always been awesome.
Absolutely.
And it's just an incredible community,
yep.
Great place to live. And they had great passion behind the program, and you know, and we worked deliriously, and it wasn't like work. It was like, it was your life, and it was something that we wanted to create, and I wanted to really create it for so many different reasons. One, I love football, but the impact and influence you could have on young people's lives is enormous. And why do guys have to go all over the country, you know, to play great football?
Right.
Well, they didn't need to. And I grew up seeing University of Tampa and what they did, and Freddie Solomon and so forth. And, you know, I embraced that program, and it just felt like it was just a great moment, you know, to be able to do something like this.
Yeah, coming from the mobile home trailers. And,
right.
And, you know, shouts out, while you're talking about the coaches, running through my mind was Mark Stoops. Did a great job with us defensive backs. You know.
Mark, I paid Mark $12,000. I remember, I'll never forget this. We had trailers, and we had nobody that would clean the floors or wash the windows or do any of that stuff. So we all drew, this is a true story, we drew numbers out of a hat. Somebody was going to vacuum the carpet. Somebody was going to cut the grass. Somebody was going to wash the windows. Well, Mark drew the number that he had to clean the bathrooms.
Oh, no.
He had to do the toilets. And Mark says, I'll coach, but I do not clean toilets.
Oh,
I said, Mark, come with me. And I helped him do that. This is a true story.
It's an unbelievable.
And that's
story,
how it started, you know. And,
great story.
You know, and after 6 years, we're beating a lot of people and doing some really remarkable things. And it says a lot to the players. And I used to tell the players all the time, you'll never realize what's really going on here. And you really won't realize it for probably 20 years. But 20 years from now, you're going to look back and you're going to realize how powerful this time was and what impact and influence you had on an entire community, an entire state, an entire nation at what you are doing right now.
Yeah.
And we had great discipline. We had great love. And those are the only two words I really talked about. Never had any issues through all those years. And great guys. And I mean, it was just, it's a great story.
You know, quick story about Mark Stoops. All the rage back then was Deion Sanders. You know, the commercial came out with Jerry Jones, you know, 15, 20 million, oh, both, you know. And then the rage was when Deion was at the line of scrimmage, he dropped that one leg back. Remember that?
Mm-hmm,
so he got in a stance and everybody's like, oh, look at Deion. He's flashy. What's he doing? Mark Stoops said, Brandon, guys, you know, we all kind of were there at a teaching session, at practice one day. He said, Brandon, all he's doing is putting that drop step back. You know, take that drop step, you gather, you get to the 45, you shoot the hands under, you know, you deflect that receiver, you know, move that receiver either way, get into your bump and run technique. So it's really awesome to have coaches like that. So I commend you for bringing in Mark. I mean, he did a great job coaching. And we're coming into our first segment break, but more with Coach Leavitt here when we come back. Coach Jim Leavitt, the inaugural coach at the University of South Florida football team that I played on. And you know, more from our experts here as well, Connor Anthony in studio, and just a great conversation. We're going to kind of go chronological order here. Maybe let's talk about some of that butt kicking in the rankings that we got up to number two.
Games.
Up to number two in the nation. So we're going to talk about that when we come back. So stay with us. The best is yet to come. You're listening to the Real Estate Quarterback Show and RealEstateRadioTampa.com.
This is Warwick Dunn, and you're listening to the Real Estate Quarterback Show hosted by my man, Brandon Rimes.
All right, welcome back. Thanks for sticking with us. Brandon Rimes, host of the Real Estate Quarterback Show. I'm the owner of Platinum MVP Realty. and a top listing agent here in Tampa Bay. Featured in Florida Realtor Magazine multiple times, recognized for innovations with marketing, helping our sellers profit more on the sale of their real estate properties. This segment is brought to you by Total Title Solutions. Total Title does a great job on all of our title and underwriting the liens and searches on the properties. And if you're a for sale by owner, you can reach out to them direct as well. We want to remind you our website is realestateradiotampa.com, and our consumer advocate hotline is 813-917-1894. And we do have a property of the month here. We've got 414 South Royal Palm Way in Tampa. This is a $1.27 million property in Beach Park. Beautiful Beach Park listing of mine here at 4 bedrooms, 3 full bath, 2 half bath. And it's a distinguished South Tampa beautiful property. Historical flavor to this property. Large fenced-in backyard with a great estate-style pool. And it's listed at $1.27 million. Owners are motivated at 414 South Royal Palm Way in Tampa. That's our property of the month. So in studio, got Coach Jim Levitt here in studio and reminiscing on some of the great stories of USF football, some of the inception. So now, you know, we covered the early years.
Right.
Let's talk a little bit about, you know, how we started coming in and just defeating some of these powerhouses that people didn't think. You know, that's the underdog. I was the underdog my whole life.
Right.
Undersized quarterback, option style, down in South Florida. You know my story somewhat, Coach.
But you had a great – you guys did great.
That's right. LaBelle. It's all about the team approach, you know, getting mentally ready. My dad coached us in Pop Warner. We played in Pop Warner, right. Super Bowl number one, you know, the very first Super Bowl. So a lot of it is the mentality behind, you know, going out and being ready to play ball.
Right.
So let's talk about some of the winning that we did and being ranked final ranking of number – or a ranking of number two in the nation at one point.
Well, you know, it was a great story, you know, and I never want anybody ever to underestimate what they could do in life, and I certainly didn't want our players to ever feel that way, and that was very important to me because I felt like the God had given these guys great talent. We had some real talented young men, and you know, a lot of it mentally and psychologically is just getting over the hurdle that hey, we can play with anybody, and not only play with anybody, we can beat them.
Yep.
And you know the. And we worked extremely hard. The guys later on, you know, I was at South Florida for about 14 years before I got let go. And, you know, at the last 4 or 5 years, the guys said I got real soft, so I don't know. But we worked very, very hard early. Yeah. And we you know, I think the team and everybody demanded to win and not to let anybody be on a team that was not somebody that mentally wasn't ready, or, you know, we went every game expecting to win.
That's right.
And getting a fourth quarter and pulling it off. And we pulled off so many close games.
Yep.
And I think that mentality is what really, really helped. But we really felt like we didn't need to take the back seat to anybody. And, you know, we had a chance to, you know, beat West Virginia.
Yep.
Certainly was a big win here on a Friday night game, and it was a sellout. We sold out Raymond James Stadium about 5 times.
Wow.
And you know, beating Central Florida all 4 times was big, and then beating Louisville when they were 9th in the nation, beating Kentucky when they were 18th in the nation, going to Auburn when they were ranked and beating them, and going to Florida State when they were ranked.
Yep.
After they just beat BYU and beating them, I mean, you know, there's a lot of, you know, I went back to West Virginia when they were 5th again and beat them again. And, you know, the reason I share those things is what made that happen was certainly not Jim Levitt. What made that happen was the community of Tampa and St. Pete and this whole Tampa Bay area, the players. I want to make sure that the players that were involved in all those games, you know, understand how much they did. And you know, it was a great experience. You know, it was really a lot of fun. You know, so we got up to number two in the nation, and we didn't hold it for very long, but we were up there. We stayed up there to top 20 for quite a while. And then the next year, when we beat Kentucky, we were up number 10 in the BCS poll. So you have to do that after 6-7 games. And the year I was let go, we went up to Florida State and beat them, and we ended up 8-5, and that was probably our worst season in 6 years.
Yeah.
And but we were able to get to 18th in the BCS that year, and that was a very young team. I know when Coach Holtz came in, he inherited a very, very talented young team.
Yep.
And he did a very good job. They won a bunch of games, and got to know Skip very well. I felt bad for him that, you know, he probably, you know, sometimes when you get really, really pretty good. Mm-hmm. You don't realize how much work it takes and all those kind of things. And, you know, sometimes maybe you should have been given some more time. I don't know. But, you know, coaching is coaching. It is what it is. So, but great stories, great wins, had a lot of fun, great crowds. We averaged, I think, 51 or 53,000 the last year I was here. And I remember our Miami game, which was the last home game I coached, and we had 61,000 at the game. A really good game. Had George Selvey, Pierre Paul, you know, as the outside guys. And, you know, we had 38 guys going to the NFL, 18 made active rosters, and I think now four or five of them have Super Bowl rings. So it was a lot of really talented players that went through the University of South Florida.
Yeah, and many reasons why. You know, and I know you're being modest there, Coach, but, you know, the team needs a leader. You were the leader that led us to that pinnacle of being ranked number two. So, you know, hats off to you as well. And a lot of the recruiting side of it is such a key component of all of football. Maybe talk a little bit about some of the recruiting side and how that affected the teams and what kind of trends you might see happening.
Well, it was easy for me. I enjoyed recruiting, and I enjoyed meeting people, and I enjoyed being involved in their lives and enjoyed meeting the parents, you know, so the process wasn't hard for me. I really had fun doing it. And I certainly had fun recruiting in my home state, you know, and, you know, where I grew up. And that certainly is something that Coach Taggart, I'm sure, is one reason they're building it back up here and winning some games. Because it's not hard to sell a school, you know, because there's passion involved, you know, when you're from here. And so, you know, but we had a great network. We had a lot of people work together. Again, like I said, Paul Griffin was so instrumental. Yeah. And to be honest with you, Betty Castor, the first president, was awesome.
Wow.
When she left, I told her I would never forgive her, ever. And I don't think I've been around a lot of presidents, and I haven't been around anybody better than her, ever, not even close. She was a special, special person, and she and I were very close, and she really understood the process and how much it was going to take. And, you know, we didn't have, again, much money at all.
Right.
You know, like I said, the highest paid coordinator I had those first 6-7 years was about $37,000. In fact, the last year I was here, my coordinators were making $180,000. That was all.
Yeah.
So it was not like we were using a lot of money. We were the community. The community was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
People were really great. So, you know, that part was great. Now, the recruiting has been interesting for me because then I go to the San Francisco 49ers and you don't recruit because you draft, you know, and so you don't go through all the process. And now, as I've entered back in as a defensive coordinator at University of Colorado, the social media has changed my life somewhat because I don't like to. I'm not big with the social media. I'd rather get on a phone and call somebody and say, hey, John, I want you to come to the University of Colorado, one of the most beautiful places in the country.
Yeah.
Incredible facilities. We just spent $160, $170 million on facilities.
Wow.
It's just awesome. And but, you know, you can't do that. Or I'd rather just drive to somebody, sit down with a mom, dad, and just talk about it. But you just can't do that because of all the rules. And so you got direct message and do this and that, and you know. So I'm kind of getting used to it now. But I'm not a real social media guy. So, and I think people that know me would say that sounds about right.
Yeah. It's a different world we live in than of course 10, 15, 20 years ago. It's an interesting playing field now.
And then I get emails. I probably get 50 emails a day.
Yep.
Players want me to look at their huddle. You know, and
yeah,
and it takes me forever to get through it because I always feel bad. Sometimes I'll stay on the weekends and just sit in my office and look at film because these guys are somebody's son.
Yep.
You know, and I feel like they've taken all that work to send me an email, so I need to watch their huddle tape. Now, you can imagine how much time that takes because out of probably 2,000 people sending me something, maybe there's one or two guys that you're going to, at a high level, because we play in a Pac-12, which is one of the best conferences in the country.
Yeah,
it's a Power 5 conference.
It's a P5 conference, and I like coaching at the highest level. And that's the one thing that was fun about South Florida, because we were in kind of going off on a tangent here.
Yep.
We were in the Big East, and that was really big. We were playing at a very high level, and I recruit that way. They're not now. They're in a good conference, but it's not the same.
Yeah.
It's not the P5 level, and you're not playing with the same type of deal, your schedule. You know, like next year we're going to play at Michigan.
Yep.
You know, we're going to play USC, UCLA, Arizona State. We're going to play Stanford there. We've got Washington State. We play Oregon State. And, Colorado State, our opener. And that's a pretty strong schedule.
Yeah.
You don't have that same schedule anymore where they're at now. But they're in a good conference, and they'll do well, and they'll win games. And, you know, they're at the level probably that their administration has taken them to, you know, to be quite honest with you. That's just where it's at. And it's not – I'm not saying a negative, but it's a different – the whole thing is really different. So I enjoy that at a Colorado being at the P5 level.
Yeah, yeah, it's awesome. I think, next segment, too, we'll talk about – let's talk about focusing on the 49ers and the playoff runs and the Super Bowl and the blacked-out Super Bowl and some of the cool things happening in the NFL. You coached Anquan Boldin, or not directly coached him, but I played against him in high school. Right. And, you know, NFL Walter Payton Man of the Year winner and down from Belgrade, LaBelle area where I'm from. So maybe touch on that a little bit. You also recruited the Grammatica brothers down out of LaBelle, my hometown there, Martin, Bill, and –
Santiago.
Right. Yeah, that's right. So more from Coach Levitt and the Real Estate Quarterback Show here, having a lot of fun reminiscing some of the good old days, some of the footballs. And, ex-athletes, we always love to think back and look back at some of the days. So stay with us. The best is yet to come. You're listening to the Real Estate Quarterback Show and realestateradiotampa.com.
This is Work Done, and you're listening to the Real Estate Quarterback Show hosted by my man, Brandon Rimes.
All right, welcome back. Thanks for sticking with us. I'm Brandon Rimes, host of the Real Estate Quarterback Show. I'm the owner of Platinum MVP Realty, and here in studio with Coach Jim Levitt. This segment is brought to you by the Maids Cleaning Service. They do a great job cleaning all of our real estate properties. They come in and out, four fine folks in and out, and let you know who was there, the time that they were there. And that is shouts out to the Maids Cleaning Service, referred for a reason. And this segment is back in studio here with Coach Levitt, Jim Levitt here in studio. And maybe let's backtrack a little bit. We're going to talk about the 49ers, the NFL. Right. And let's talk a little bit about, you know, it says here in October 14th, South Florida received its first ever BCS ranking, number two team in the nation behind only the Ohio State Buckeyes. But, you know, maybe talk about some of the off-field impacts, people that, you know, they're not following the program as closely, you know, talking about some of the TV contracts and things like that that affect, you know, because that's going to trickle down to the community. It's going to trickle down to the coaching staff. You know,
right.
What did you see going on around that time period?
Well, you know, it was an unbelievable year because people talk about 2007 quite a bit, you know, when they talk about the history of University of South Florida. We were, you know, we got up number two in the nation. We lost that heartbreaker to Rutgers, but on basically about the last play of the game.
Yep.
And we got the fumble. I know Ben Moffitt got the fumble, and we had the ball at about the 50, but we couldn't drive it. And we lost the game, and we needed to coach better. That's all there is to it. You know, we didn't coach the game good enough. But then it was interesting was we lost the next two in a row, both on the last play of the game. And what was – people don't realize about the story about that year. Yes, we had number two in the nation, and we didn't hold it. There was about eight teams that were all number two in the nation that year. I know California Berkeley was in the same position, ended up losing the next week. All of them were losing the next, like right after they got that ranking. But what was I think very powerful about that year was the way we pulled out of it.
Right.
Because you know you're sitting there, you lost three games on about the last play of the game, and you it's just breaking your heart because you love those players so much and you don't know what to do. And I remember getting Larry Antonucci, who was our director of football operations, to buy a shovel. We were going to play Syracuse. I said, just buy a shovel. And he looked at me. He goes, why? I said, just buy the shovel. So he bought a shovel, and I brought the whole team together that night, and we all grabbed home the shovel, and it's signifying how deep we have all got to dig together to win a football game because it's hard to win. And we beat the dog out of Syracuse that day, and then we beat the dog out of Louisville, and then we beat the dog out of Pittsburgh up there in an unbelievable game. And then we got our, you know, we got back up to about 20th, I think, in the country, and we ended up playing Oregon in the out there in El Paso in the Sun Bowl. And I thought our practices were awesome. I thought it was great, but that they're a lot better team than us. They just were. We their line of scrimmage was really good. We did not coach near good enough in that game, but they're a better team. They beat us, and things were really hot. And we were getting some unbelievable, TV games, and the ratings were really big, and all those kind of things. And you know what happens in these conferences, these P5 conferences, is the financial contracts for these TV, with the conferences are unbelievable. You know, you're looking at hundreds of millions of dollars and billions of dollars, so that's the one thing that is really big about being in a P5 conference. And you know, I know in South Florida, I know they when we were there in the Big East, they had a chance to get some major contracts. I don't know exactly what happened, but I think there was a point there.
Yep.
Where South Florida could have signed on with ABC, ESPN. I'm not sure because I wasn't, I wasn't here. I was with the Niners.
Yep.
And I think it was worth a lot of money.
Yeah.
But for some reason did not do it.
Close to 20 million.
You know, I don't know what the number was, but it was a lot.
Yep.
And decided not to do it. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, your groups maybe you get a little greedy. Possibly.
Right.
And again, I don't know the story, but then I think Louisville left. I had heard that Rutgers had left, and somebody else popped out of the conference, and then all of a sudden they were not the Big East anymore. Then you had the basketball schools, and then you know now you might be looking at signing contracts that are a lot less. And that's what's sad about it. If those kind of things happen, you do have a chance to lose a lot of revenue. So I don't know the whole story behind all of it. I know that It was too bad, you know, that I'll say USF, because I think that's what everybody refers USF. I'm a South Florida guy, but that they it was too bad they weren't able to stay into the P5 level.
Right.
Because this community is a P5 community, right, in my opinion. It's incredible what they did to build the program, and it was really the first teamers. I have to go back to a group called the First Teamers, people that gave $50,000 each to the program and their hard-earned money, which was incredible. But like I said before, they're in a good conference. You know, there's some really good teams in that conference, and hopefully they'll win the conference. And do very well. I think they will. There's no reason they shouldn't. You're in an incredible location. It's a great university, no question. The faculty, I always thought were awesome. So anyway, it's really the TV money's big, It's really big, you're talking a lot. So it's big exposure. Plus, people want to play at the highest level. They want to be involved at the highest level if they can. And that's why I love the University of Colorado. Like I said, it's a beautiful place. They won a national championship a number of years ago.
Yep.
They've fallen on hard times lately, and that's one of the reasons I went there. I walked in with 125th defense in the nation. This year we finished 70th, which is not near good enough. It's not real good. But compared to what they did, we were the third most improved defense in the country, most improved defense in the Pac-12, and the highest finish they've had defensively in the Pac-12 since they went into the conference, which means that we're on our way. It doesn't mean that we're good enough, because we're not. And we've got a long way to go, and we need to recruit well, and we need to get players there that want to be a part of a great story and play in the Pac-12 and help us build that defense. So it's exciting, for me right now. My family loves it there, and it is beautiful. I used to say that this area was the most beautiful in the country, but Colorado ain't bad.
It's
not bad.
It's a nice
by those mountains that are close to the heavens. So, I really enjoy that part of it all.
Yeah, nice complimentary. You come down here for a while, visit mom, and hang out, and go to see Mickey over there, Mickey Mouse, and have some, and maybe enjoy the beaches here in Tampa. But yeah, we're real bullish on Tampa Bay. Tampa Bay real estate, great place to live, work, and play.
Oh, I like that.
We got the buttons, we have fun.
I like
with the
these segues, and this music comes in, and it kind of just gets me floating around the room.
Here's another one.
Oh, yeah. This is good stuff. Good stuff.
We have a lot of fun,
Yeah, you better not get me singing, or that they'll turn the show off right now.
If you just join us, you're listening to Coach Jim Leavitt here on the Real Estate Quarterback Show. Connor, Anthony in studio as well. And, Connor, we want to transition a little bit of 49er talk. What's your question about 49ers or NFL?
I was just, a couple things. First, I was interested, I remember the Colin Kaepernick, phenomenon when he came up. And, I've always been a huge Alex Smith guy, and there's always been that debate. Did they make the wrong pick not taking Rodgers, but I've always been, he went through 8 offensive coordinators or however many.
Right.
But what was it like being, obviously you're on the other side of the ball, but still when he came on, it was all over NFL Network, Sports Center, Sports Illustrated. Colin Kaepernick was like the man, and now they're basically like over the offseason, he's done, he's out there. So what was it like being on the team when he was coming up?
Well, it was really exciting for me because I always wanted to be in the NFL, and I didn't think I ever would be, but I thought, I loved being here so much. I turned down a lot of different opportunities to stay at South Florida because it's my home and where I grew up and started the program. And then when I was let go, Jim Harbaugh called me and wanted me to come and coach linebackers at the 49ers. And, it was right. It was exactly the same time I settled the lawsuit, and then took the job. So here I was going from a lawsuit with the University of South Florida to living in San Francisco, and it was all good. Not only did I know that, I mean, not only part of that, but I always my wife and I, in fact, got married in California.
Okay.
So we always were kind of partial to that part of the country. I didn't know I'd have the opportunity to go there. And the first year we go to the NFC Championship game and play the Giants, and against Jason Pierre-Paul and Jaquan Williams, who played for me at South Florida, and it was an unbelievable experience. And then the next year, Colin comes in there, and Alex is an unbelievable guy. Right. One of the greatest guys you ever met. His wife, Liz, is very close with my wife, and they're good friends, and they continue to be. And I loved him. I thought he was a great, great quarterback and a great person and a great leader. And then here comes Colin, and who is very gifted, you know, runs so well and can run and throw and do all those things. So the next year, we play for another NFC championship. The next year we went to the Super Bowl.
Yep.
And here I am a couple of years in the NFL, never been in the NFL, and I get to be a part of an NFC championship game, and then I'm in New Orleans playing in the Harbaugh versus Harbaugh and on the sidelines, and it was unbelievable.
Save that for experience. Next segment. Okay, yeah, we're going to segue there. We got to take a network break. But, yeah, we're talking with Coach Leavitt here, talking about some of the interesting twists and turns that happen in life, and you just overcome it and keep rocking. And NFL stories coming up, Super Bowl championship games, playing against former players from the University of South Florida in the playoffs, and what an unbelievable career. Still going as well with Coach Leavitt here. So, hey, stay with us. The Real Estate Quarterback Show, the best is yet to come. And Real Estate Radio Tampa.
This is Warwick Dunn, and you're listening to the Real Estate Quarterback Show, hosted by my man, Brandon Rimes.
Thanks for sticking with us. Brandon Rimes here, host of the Real Estate Quarterback Show, owner of Platinum MVP Realty, top listing agent here in Tampa Bay. We are looking for sales associates out there as well. If you're looking for a unique and innovative approach to real estate, reach out, Real Estate Radio Tampa. ChristianHolland.com and 813-917-1894. Here in studio with Coach Levitt, Jim Levitt, the orchestrator of the inaugural team at USF, which I had a great fortune to be part of, and a lot of great guys, a lot of great memories there. And we're kind of talking a little about the NFL now, and you know, going into the NFL, coaching at that elite level, some of the awesome players that you're working with, the genius minds of you know, Harbaugh and the different Singletaries and some of those guys that were around you. But yeah, so
you know, really in that Super Bowl when we had Harbaugh versus Harbaugh was an incredible moment. And, you know, we came down to a last play of the game. Otherwise, I could have a Super Bowl ring on my finger. I guess that wasn't meant to be. And but it was, you know, it's interesting because all week leading up, my wife was there. She went out and did all the parties, all that kind of stuff. I was buried in the film room the whole time. In fact, yeah. My reminder list for the linebackers for Pat Willis and Navarro Bowman, those guys, was 16 pages. You know, wow. That I wrote down and tried to draw some, not do all writing, but some illustrations and things about the Ravens and their offense. And I can remember working extremely hard because it's about winning that game.
Yeah.
And I wanted to make sure at the end of the game that I gave everything in my power to allow for mainly Pat and Navarro to play a great game. And they played very well in that game. And it just wasn't meant to be, and it was so, I always watched these Super Bowls. I always saw the confetti coming down, and I always thought in my mind when I grew up and saw those games, I don't want to be on that side losing that game. And here I was, you know, yeah. And it was, I mean, it was incredible. I was on a high, and I love it when games, you know, before the game is always no fun for me because I get so excited about a game. But when the game starts, it's like I'm in my element. It's like Everything is – I'm at peace with everything. And so I had it was a great experience.
Yep.
And then the next year we play up at Seattle lose in an unbelievable game. Another tip pass at the end. They went on to just bury the Broncos.
Yep.
And, you know, and now I'm a big Bronco fan because I'm right
there in Colorado.
And Kayvon Webster, you know, who played for me at – that I recruited and played for me at South Florida. Oh, there it is. Oh, my. Yeah, I know it. Unbelievable. So we – you know, it was just a great experience. And then the last year when I know Jim and, you know, the ownership or whatever happened, I don't, you know, I'm not in that room. I'm glad I don't want to be in all that drama. Went through too much of that drama at South Florida. He was let go, and Jim's the one that brought me in there. So I knew that I was going to be let go. I mean, it was only a matter of time.
Cleaning house,
It's just the way it is, and I understood that. And we had Vic Fangio was a tremendous D coordinator, and we were in the top three defenses all 4 years in the NFL. We had some really good defenses and played really well. But it wasn't about that. It was about the relationship and all that kind of stuff. So when they said that they were going to go another direction, I had already, 2 weeks before that, I already moved everything out. I just knew it was a matter of time. And I had a number of opportunities to go to different places. And just like it, you know, when it was like going to South Florida, I had a number of opportunities. And you're always looking for the right match and where it's best for you. And Colorado always loved it. I knew Bill McCartney for years, and it had some great teams. And he had in fact offered me an opportunity to go to Colorado at one time, and you know, to go there and try to be a part of building this in a very challenging situation is kind of what I'm all about.
Yeah.
You know, to try to do something that people just quite frankly think you cannot do it.
Love it.
There's no way. And it's just like with South Florida. How many people, I'll never forget all the people in the media and all the people around when I was hired. Well, you know, you might last here a year or 2 years. There's no way they're going to win.
Yeah.
There's no way in the world you can win. You're in an NFL city. You start with an abandoned trailer, and you're going to go out and do what? You know, with $90,000 as your salary, $60,000 budget.
Yeah.
The recruiting budget was $40,000. So how far do you think that would take my old Ford that I drive right now? Not very far. You know, so it's, I mean, it's unbelievable. But what you can do with passion and what you can do
right.
with purpose and what you can do with a staff that buys in and invests together with you,
right.
What you could do with people. people that have single purpose of mind and that understand that you do not ever underestimate what you could do as a person or as a staff or as a player is amazing. You can move mountains. You
That's
can
right.
do amazing things. And I felt like, you know, I felt like we were able to do that. And I'm very proud of all the players who went through the program. Very, very proud that I'm from this community.
Yep.
So many people. Awesome.
Yep.
And, it's too bad what all happened at the end there. That was tough. No question
yeah.
about it. And, you know, the thing that I'm proud of is that I never lied about anything. Always yep. told the truth. And,
yep.
And that's just the way it is. And, for some reason, people want to go another direction, want to do different things. And
yep.
that's their prerogative. So,
yeah.
But what happened after that was I was very fortunate. I was very
yep.
blessed because you don't know if you're going to be able to coach again. You don't know what's going to happen. You don't know who's going to give you the opportunity.
Yep.
You know, to go to San Francisco 49ers and to be a part of a Jim Harbaugh staff and to be a part of 3 NFC championship games and a Super Bowl and then be allowed to go to University of Colorado and be a part of the program there and to do the things we're doing and to live where we live. Very, very fortunate and I understand that. I've had an incredible career. I hope I can work till I'm 100, will I be a head coach again? I'm not sure. I've had a number of opportunities, but I just didn't feel like it was the right fit, the right match, the right way to go. And, you pray about it. You think about it a lot. And I just feel like the steps that have been in the doors that have been opened in my life is just where I'm supposed to be. And, I wasn't supposed to be at South Florida any longer. It was just clear. The door was closed. So, the Niners worked out. So it was great.
But, what you say it wasn't, the mainstream media. Here's what that's
right.
what one of our goals of our show is the cynicism in the mainstream media. That you see it in this election cycle, this nauseating 24/7 election cycle that we're in.
All
and
right.
So many times you read a story and you want to say,
Come on, man.
These guys, these writers and the you got the right and the left, you got this far extremes, and these guys
right.
come in and to see how they can just change someone's life. And it's just amazing.
Yeah, it's the way it is. But this is a thing in life. First of all, nobody ever said it was going to be fair.
Right.
And you got to understand that, and that's very important to you. And important to me. And and of course, at times I want to jump up on top of a mountain and just scream and say, "Hey, look, this and that." But just. It wasn't the way it was going to be,
Right.
And the thing is, you can't worry about things you can't control.
Exactly.
And, it's easier said than done.
Yeah.
But that is very, very important. I've had incredible experiences. I look more to the positive on things, and it was the case here where people didn't want me here, and that was the bottom line. And that was okay.
Yeah.
I just didn't like the way it was done is all,
Yeah.
And you fight as hard as you can for the credibility,
Yep.
And that's what I did. And
Yep.
that's why I filed a lawsuit,
Yep.
and went through the process because I wanted people to realize that the way it was portrayed might not be exactly the way it was portrayed,
Yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
So, it's all good. There's things worked out incredibly well for me.
Yep.
The opportunity I had at South Florida was an awesome one. I can't thank Paul Griffin and Betty Castor enough for allowing me to be there. I can't thank the community enough for allowing me to be there 14 almost, they're great years.
Yeah.
And a lot of great experiences, a lot of neat things. And then I really, to be honest with you, it allowed me the opportunity to coach in the Super Bowl and coach NFC Championship game. So, it all works out, and you focus on the positives, and you just keep going.
Got about a minute and a half left, but I know
all right.
before the break we were talking about the Bucks coach. What do you talk about?
I love
talk
Dirk. He's a good man, and I've known Dirk a long time. He was at Missouri when I was at Kansas State. We played against each other, and then when I was head coach of South Florida, he was at Boise and Arizona State, and we have a very good relationship. He was the offensive coordinator
yep.
of the Atlanta Falcons when the 49ers went into Atlanta and won that game. in an incredible game.
Wow.
And I remember talking to Dirk about it afterwards. So I'm really excited for the Bucks. I'm excited for Dirk. He's a very good coach. I'm sure that he'll assemble a great staff. I know his defense coordinator I know extremely well. Mike up at, that was up in Atlanta. What a great man he is. Right. He is awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. So I think that they'll do great things, you know, and I think they'll do really well. So so I think it was a good hire. I think they'll do well, I don't follow the USF as much, but I do still follow the Bucks, you know. I still watch them, and I had a chance to meet the Glazers and be around them, and Brian and Joel, and my wife knows them, and lived out at Harbor Island, know them, and so I think it's all good, and you know, hopefully they'll do very, very well, and get to the playoffs, and be successful in the playoffs.
Well, Coach, thanks for coming in. Coach Levitt, appreciate it. A lot of great stories there, great memories, and just an awesome show. So
Brandon,
we wish you all the best.
Thank you, Connor. Appreciate it.
Thanks for coming on, Coach. We appreciate it.
Yep. All right, so check out the same place, same time, at 7 p.m. here on 1250 Winds, and Sundays, 7 a.m. on 102.5 The Bone.